Good evening. Thank you for coming tonight to hear Reverend Dr. Jean Murphy at our fourth and final Obenhaus lecture of the school year. I wanted to let you know there's a microphone in the back, so if you have a question afterwards, if you can stand up and go to the microphone or hand it to someone, that way the voice will be captured for our live stream audience. Feel free to get more food as you wish, and I'll turn it over to Jean. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for being here. And please let me begin by thanking Dr. Emily Vogt and the PhD department for inviting me to present this work to the CTS community. The intent of this evening's talk is to reintroduce us to the lesser-known writings of Dolores S. Williams, allowing her prophetic voice to again speak to those of us who are concerned with social justice and the mission of the church. It is also intended to introduce Dr. Dolores S. Williams to those who have not had the opportunity to meet or to know her personally as her student, colleague, or friend. It is for those who did not have the pleasure of hearing the timbre of her unique voice that began speaking loudly to the predicament of Black Americans and the shame of the dominant culture and white Protestant Christianity in the 1980s. It will remind those of us who have had the privilege to be in her company that she had charged us with the task of critiquing the culture and the church in order to determine our own roles in speaking truth to power in love. While teaching a womanist theology course at a seminary in Detroit, I used her book, Sisters in the Wilderness, The Challenge of Womanist God Talk, as one of my main texts. In my own research, I have delightfully discovered that there are more published writings by Dr. Williams that address areas not specifically dealt with in Sisters. I find these to be important pieces of information that will help us to understand more fully her theology and her passion for social justice, particularly for the African American community, but also for all oppressed people. Before gaining her notoriety as the Paul Tillich Professor of Theology and Culture at Union Theological Seminary in New York City, she was Professor of Theology and Culture at the Theological School of Drew University in Madison, New Jersey. It was there that as a student, I first encountered her in a course she taught entitled God and Community in the Literature of Afro-American Women. Her teaching style was engaging and challenging. Dr. Williams had an uncanny yet gentle way of meeting you where you were and moving you to a more enlightened, theological, and socially conscious space. She would begin most class sessions by peering over her glasses and asking the question, "Who do you say God is?" We were gently pushed till each student could introspectively reflect on how God had acted in his or her life. I loved that class and was totally hooked on the style, passion, and personality of Dolores S. Williams. From that point on, I took every class she taught. And so it was at the feet of Dr. Dolores S. Williams that I cut my theological teeth. She introduced me to Black, liberation, womanist, Mujerista, and Asian theologies, to ethics and cultural critique, and taught me how to develop a deeper social consciousness and sensitivity to oppressed people worldwide. I consider it then a great honor and privilege to have been personally introduced to womanist theology when it was still in its infancy, by one considered to be a founding mother and who is credited with giving the discipline its name. This lecture, then, is my way of honoring my theological mother, Dr. Dolores S. Williams, and the impact she has had and still has on my life as a Black woman and as a womanist theologian. It is my way of saying thank you for helping me to find, accept, and nurture the confident writer, artist, and womanist theologian who now resides in me. Many in the Academy are familiar with her seminal work, Sisters in the Wilderness, The Challenge of Womanist God Talk. Some may also be familiar with her articles, Womanist Theology, Black Women's Voices, and The Color of Feminism, or Speaking the Black Woman's Tongue. However, I have learned that few are aware that there are over 50 additional essays and writings by Dr. Williams that were published in journal articles or anthology contributions from 1985 to 2006. Dr. Williams was a regular contributor to journals and magazines such as the Journal of Religious Thought, Christianity in Crisis, the Journal of Feminist Studies in Religion, Women's Studies Quarterly, Church and Society, Christian Century, The Other Side, The Living Pulpit, and Sojourners. Her essays appear in womanist and feminist compilations edited by Emily Towns, Cheryl J. Sanders, Laylee Phillips, Elizabeth Susher Fiorenza, Phyllis Tribble, Letty Russell, and others. Students from Drew and Union have been the recipients of her wisdom, scholarship, and insight. In her classes and in her writings, she raised profound questions pointed at American culture and society, but particularly aimed at Christianity, American style. These critical questions asked through her womanist lens and commitment to the survival and wholeness of African American women and their communities are still relevant today. And her responses offer a blueprint to follow as we continue to strive for racial, gender, class, economic, and political justice and equity. I believe there is an acute timing and urgency in this present moment that requires her prophetic voice to once again be heard by those of us who take seriously our faith, our stance for social justice, and our call to tell the story. This evening, we will probe the thoughts and arguments of Dolores S. Williams from six select articles that highlight her keen observations, and we will hear her prophetic warnings that continue to speak loudly, boldly, and poignantly into today's predicament. Words that can pique our collective and individual consciousness and call us to be on guard, to re-examine our faith and how we express our belief in a God of love. What and who is a prophet? Biblical prophetic voices were spiritual, but also intensely political. Prophets usually began their messages by reminding the people of their history, explaining their present predicament and how they found themselves there, and then gave a word from God that would lift them from despair and offer hope. Prophets would give instruction for future actions that would raise the people out of the difficult situations in which they found themselves. In his newest book, American Prophets, Seven Religious Radicals and Their Struggle for Social and Political Justice, Albert Rabiteau describes a prophet as one who is in fellowship with the feelings of God, sympathy with the divine pathos, in communion with the divine consciousness. The prophet hears God's voice and feels God's heart, is one who is impelled to speak because she feels the divine pathos like a fire in the bones. He further says that a prophet is moved to action by deep compassion of human suffering and analyzes theological and ethical positions in order to mobilize hearers to action that will affect social change. This aptly describes Dolores S. Williams, who fearlessly challenged the status quo and had a way of presenting probing questions intending to sear our consciousness and move us to examine ourselves in the social predicaments of our time in new and expanding ways. We will listen as she continues to engage us in critical thought, in theological, cultural and social reflection, and ponder again from our own individual and collective faith traditions, who do you say God is? Through Dr. Williams' skillful and honest exploration and presentation of the groundings and the undercurrents of America's historic past, we will be brought to our present social and political predicaments. And we will hear her words of encouragement and hope, and the instructions she has given to us for survival. One of her earliest published addresses in 1986 was a response to both white feminist theologians and black church women. This essay, The Color of Feminism, or Speaking the Black Woman's Voice, was her critique of white feminist understanding of patriarchy as the main source for all women's oppression. She reminded the feminists that they were afflicted with racism and unable to see or address the specific issues of black women within their movement. Her response to the black women who informed her that feminism looks real pretty, but there just ain't enough in it to fit me, was to recognize that there was a need for a new language that allowed African American women to describe their own oppression with new words, new language, and new ideas. And she raised this question: what additional materials have to be added to feminism to make it fit black women's experience? She believed that black women's struggle for liberation goes beyond patriarchal oppression and is a direct result of racist activity against African American women and their communities. Deeming racism as demonic and calling it the demon in the land, Dr. Williams uses the term demonarchy and says this: demonarchy is the way in which institutional white rule controls black women's lives and bodies, using racism, violence, violation, retardation, and death as instruments of social control. Further, she says, racism is a traditional and collective expression of white government in relation to black women, which has roots in American slavery and has prevailed until now. This demonarchy includes government or institutional systems targeting any and all non-whites or whites who threaten the idea of white nationalism. Our present political climate has made it easy to recognize demonarchy, for we clearly see evil in high places. There have been blatant acts of violence against minorities, foreigners, or anyone considered outside the realm of an envisioned great America. Acts of hate and domestic terrorism are on the rise. Since the 2016 election season, more hate crimes against non-whites by whites have made news headlines across the country than we have seen in the same time span since the Jim Crow and civil rights eras. People of color have been physically accosted, shot, stabbed, or killed because of their ethnicity. The burning and desecration of churches, mosques, synagogues, and cemeteries is on the rise. Hateful propaganda has been posted in public places and spread in the name of white supremacy. According to a CNN report, the Southern Poverty Law Center's annual report on extremism in America said that hate groups across the country have increased in 2016 to 917, up from 892 in 2015. The number of anti-Muslim hate groups tripled from 34 in 2015 to 101 in 2017. Along with the rise of a president whose policies reflect the values of white nationalists, the country has seen a resurgence of white nationalism that imperils the racial progress we have made, according to CNN. Dr. Williams has called us to stand firm in the face of the demonarchy we see in white-controlled institutions, particularly the institution of white Christianity, American style. She also reminds the black church that it cannot underestimate the power of demonarchy and that it is challenged to recognize that our liberation struggle is against nothing less than radical evil. And this radical evil is racism. In her 1990 article entitled Afflicted with Racism, she responds to an article by Dr. Gar Alperovich in which he described his vision of a political and economic restructuring needed to rebuild and correct the serious problems he saw in America. He believed that his restructuring would create a living democracy. Dr. Williams reminded him that his vision overlooked an important piece of American consciousness that is deeply embedded into the fabric of its political, economic, social, and religious structures, and that is racism. And she raised this question. Can this living democracy that you imagine ever be more than half dead if essential elements of a new vision do not give attention to restructuring America's consciousness with regard to racism? She contended that America will never be a living democracy until it is restructured to purge the nation of its racist, anti-Black sentiments that have been at the bottom of so much social, political, and economic thinking and acting in this country. In giving her readers a brief historical background, she highlights the definition of the word Black as found in an early Oxford dictionary to offer a partial explanation of the roots of this national anti-Black sentiment. Black, deeply stained with dirt, soiled, dirty, foul, having dark or deadly purpose, malignant, pertaining to or involving death, deadly, baneful, disastrous, sinister. This definition, she says, suggests the kind of anti-Black aesthetic and religious values that informed the consciousness and rule of English settlers during the colonial period of America. Anti-Black sentiment, and now anti-Brown, Yellow, First Nations people, Mexican, Asian, Muslim, continue the list. This sentiment has been embedded into the national psyche since the founding of the nation. Even the ways in which aesthetics are art, music, dance, drama, standards of beauty and style have been assessed and viewed in America is through anti-Black thought, which has conditioned the culture to see almost every aspect of life through anti-Black eyes. Religion through biblical interpretation, science through theories of physical anthropology, and politics through laws of exclusion have worked together to condition Americans to believe that Black people are inferior. She wrote this: "The union of politics, science, religion, and economic practices for the sake of fostering and perpetuating the national anti-Black consciousness is still intact in America. A living democracy cannot be built here as long as the national consciousness is still infected with this cancerous anti-Blackism that is the heart of white racism." In the raging undercurrent, is the gospel strong enough to encounter persistent racism? Dr. Williams observed that decades past the civil rights era of the 1960s, when some thought that the issue of racism had been addressed, racism was still the underpinning and the undercurrent of the social fabric of the nation. She said this: "Racism, the view that a dominant group in a society inherently deserves its position of privilege, is the entrenched as ever. One of her questions from this article is, why has the church and the gospel not been effective in eradicating racism in the United States?" According to Dr. Williams, the church itself has been and remains complicit in establishing, fostering, and perpetuating racism in America. She references a collection of historic documents, or anti-Black pamphlets, that were circulated widely in the United States between 1863 and 1925. These pamphlets were intended to prove one thing, that African Americans were inferior beasts and not humans. This, she says, constitutes a terrible indictment of the church and is the undercurrent at the root of white nationalism and white supremacy. She further says this: "The appalling fact that those who perpetuated and perpetrated these negative ideological thoughts were preachers." She takes an honest look at this country's history to expose how white supremacy has distorted both religion and science. These preachers based their arguments on false biblical interpretations that were nothing more than lies, combined with the lies and misinformation or false propaganda from the scientific fields of physical anthropology, eugenics, and sociobiology. These were the openings that allowed and justified a racist culture to generate and maintain itself in order to sustain its European American dominance. Furthering her indictment, she says this: although racism in this culture owes part of its established foothold to white religious leaders of the past, few contemporary white ministers and churches have made serious moves to refute and correct perceptions about the natural deficiency of black people. Most have made no real attempt to name and attack the racist consciousness endemic to this culture and their own church communities. And she also recognized this: if racism is eradicated, it very well might rend the entire fabric of our national consciousness and economic structure. If the foundations of white supremacy and black inferiority are addressed and altered, the national psychology might well collapse. But at the same time, if efforts to eradicate racism are not addressed, America may be headed for an even more destructive course. She leaves us to ponder this: if the gospel has no power to conquer the sin of racism, what meaning and value does it have at all? When I awakened after the November 8th elections to discover the Republican electoral sweep, I was shocked. Many of the leaders ushered into power in this election have expressed views deeply threatening to black Americans. We black folk cannot help but fear that the clock will be turned back and the meager social and legislative gains won through the civil rights movement revoked. These are the words of Dr. Dolores S. Williams, directly quoted from her article entitled, "Could It Happen Here? Why Genocide Against African Americans Remains a Frightening Possibility." This was written after the elections of 1994. Yet these words so closely mirrored my own feelings and anxieties after November 8, 2016, that I had to take a reflective pause. The Republican sweep of the White House, Senate, and Congress had left many feeling apprehensive, fearful, worried, agitated, and with a sense of foreboding. Though I was and still am very concerned about the social and political predicament in which we find ourselves, Dr. Williams' words helped me to remember that we as a people and a nation have been here before. The questions she raised in 1995 are the very questions and concerns that many of us grapple with in 2017, and we must expand them to include all people, programs, and organizations that may be affected by the current administration's policies. Three of her questions from this article are: one, where do church people hear the voices of Christians advocating justice? Two, how does our Christian religious tradition work to support the ultra-conservative and apathetic attitudes of non-black Christians? And three, given our Christian notions conditioned with anti-black biases from cultural and religious traditions, could our new Congress usher in such strong and violent anti-black activity that African Americans would choose to flee the United States? In his book, The Roots of Evil, The Origins of Genocide and Other Group Violence, Dr. Irvin Staub defines genocide as an attempt to exterminate a racial, ethnic, religious, cultural, or political group, either directly through murder or indirectly by creating conditions that lead to the group's destruction. Dr. Williams expressed her concern that a government-sanctioned systemic genocide of specific people groups is possible within the United States, saying that the groundwork has already been laid, and some believe it has already begun. She said this: the victories of election 1994 indicated a silent growing consensus among many whites that black people were the cause of the problems in this country and ought to be put back in bondage where they can be managed and controlled. How better to accomplish this than by giving congressional power to racist forces in the United States? Sounds familiar. This feeling toward African Americans has continued and includes any and all non-white Americans and immigrants. Building the wall, the Muslim travel ban, removing white supremacist groups from the National Terrorist Watch List, Standing Rock, police killings of black and brown people, the prison industrial system, presidential advisory and cabinet choices, Supreme Court appointees, executive orders and vice presidential tie-breaking votes against programs for women and the poor are all indicators of the groundswell of the racist, anti-black, and anti-other mood sweeping the nation. Dr. Williams might refer to these goings-on as acts of demonarchy. She reminds us of the words of a Jewish Holocaust survivor who said, many Jews in Germany did not recognize early enough the signs of the times. They missed the signals because they thought it could not happen in Wagner's Germany. Another survivor said that the genocide of the Jewish people could not have happened apart from the many generations of anti-Semitism in Europe. The historic genocide of Native Americans, the enslavement of African Americans, the internment of Japanese Americans, and the generations of anti-black and anti-other sentiment in the United States has set a precedent for genocide that cannot be ignored. The questions Dr. Williams posed to and for the African American community can be asked of all non-white communities. Do we recognize the warning signs of our times? Do we think that re-enslavement or genocide could not happen because we live in a democracy? She reminds us that anti-Semitic and anti-black sentiments have undergirded Western culture and white Western Christianity since the formation of this country. As the Jewish Holocaust occurred in Europe, many Christians were silent and passive, believing the false propaganda which claimed that the Jews were evil and the cause of the economic problems in post-World War Germany. The anti-immigrant cry heard in the United States today makes similar claims. Jobs are being stolen from white Americans by immigrants. All Muslims represent possible terrorist threats. Therefore, they should be banned from entering the country, and those who are here should be deported along with all other illegal immigrants. And many Christians remain silent, while a few vocal white fundamental evangelicals and self-allowed leaders claim that this is the will of God. Dr. Williams would have us consider this. Western cultural traditions have conditioned attitudes toward blackness and otherness, any of which can lead to the genocide of a people. For example, since the arrival of Europeans, violence against Americans, African Americans, Native Americans, Jews, Asians, women, and others has been deeply embedded in this continent's historical experience. The public is conditioned to accept violence as an effective way to resolve conflict, and it is addicted to violence through movies, dramas, politics, politicians, popular music, and video games. Scapegoating continues to be a tool of deflection. Whites commit crimes and claim they were perpetrated by black men. The sitting presidents claim that President Obama's policies were the reason for his unilateral decision to bomb Syria. The general public is conditioned to believe false propaganda or alternate facts, which claim that black people and by extension, all brown-skinned people are intellectually inferior and by nature evil and violent. And this false propaganda can be media generated and media spread. Then there is a concern that ultra-conservative Anglo-American forces and an ultra-conservative Congress might easily convince non-black Americans that the removal of American blacks from the country would secure its well-being. This is not unfounded nor without precedent. Here are just three conditions existing in the United States today that increase the possibility of genocide. And you can certainly add many more conditions as you think of them. One, legal lynchings occur through vigilante and police killings of black and brown men and women. The prison industrial system incarcerates proportionately larger numbers of African Americans and Latinos than white prisoners. The rise of alt-right groups and genocidal propaganda is increasingly more prominent. In her 1997 article, Straight Talk, Plain Talk, Dr. Williams writes this: white hate groups did not disappear. They shrank from major visibility only to return in various places. They are present in full array, organized, strong, numerous, proliferating, and apparently determined to carry out genocide against black people. Such groups are making themselves even more visible since the 2016 elections. Writing in an online blog, Osita N. Wanavu reports that an alt-right website once ran an essay called, "Is Black Genocide Right?" The following is a direct quote from this site. "Instead of asking how we can make reparations for slavery, colonialism, and apartheid, or how we can equalize academic scores and incomes, we should instead be asking questions like, does human civilization actually need the black race? Is black genocide right? And if it is, what should be the best and easiest way to dispose of them?" Close quote. In a 1993 article entitled Lethargy and Christendom, Dr. Williams wrote this: "I have no desire to be a doomsday prophet, but I do know that when the voices of dissent are silenced and advocates of justice fold up, the Fourth Reich can easily step in, cloning whatever the Third Reich was. Just when the gospel most needs to be expressed, we Christians lose our voice." Dr. Williams calls on the church in all of its forms to find its voice and not remain silent, but to ponder our faith deeply and seriously. She reminds white Christians who stand by silently while racist policies negatively affect so many that they may have become indifferent to the pain and suffering of blacks and other minorities because of the conditioning of their Christian and cultural biases and the symbols, signs, and images that Western culture and religion has used to support anti-blackness and anti-otherness. She warns us to be on guard, while reminding black Christians that the true roots of our faith lies in the religious experience of our Afro-Asian ancestors. She asks us this: if we were to reconstruct Western Christian symbols, signs, and images so that the anti-black elements are purged, would the finished product still be Christianity? She calls on all of us to exercise wisdom endowed by God, wisdom that will reveal to us and our children the kinds of resistance activity that will help our people pass through this wilderness without unrelenting despair. For Dr. Williams, attacks against houses of worship as well as cross burnings are considered acts of desecration of the symbols of the Christian faith and are considered blasphemy. She says this: to attack the black church or any house of worship is to attack the sacredness of both human and divine spirit. Referring to Matthew 12, 30 through 31, where Jesus warned that every human sin will be forgiven except blasphemy against the Holy Spirit, she believes that these blasphemous acts of desecration reflect the overall characteristic of sin in this postmodern age and represent the sin of defilement. The Pew Research Center says fires caused by arson are far more common at houses of worship than in most other kinds of structures. Combined statistics from Pew and the Center for Democratic Renewal reported that 276 black and multiracial churches had been intentionally firebombed, torched, or vandalized between 1990 and 2015. The Council of American Islamic Relations documented 139 incidents of damage, destruction, and vandalism at mosques in 2016. The Washington Post reported that in the week after 9 people were shot dead at Emmanuel AME Church in South Carolina, 5 churches with predominantly black congregations in 5 southern states were burned. For Dr. Williams, the church symbolizes a divine endowment of God's spirit in our world. The cross plays a central role in representing the resurrection and spirit of Jesus Christ. To take deliberate action to destroy or desecrate these symbols through actions or words is to speak against the spirit, to do violence to God. White supremacist assaults upon the black human spirit and the divine spirit represent one of the most destructive steps in this Western path of blasphemy, a path leading to utter perdition for those individuals and cultures who choose it. Even as she penned these words, she recognized the rapid growth of white supremacist groups in the United States and warned us that while the same white supremacist ideologies continue to drive hate and violence against African Americans, there is also a new face of racism purporting economic and political policies that reinforce segregation. And she asks, where will it all end? When will the day come that Martin Luther King Jr.'s envisioned, a day when all people will live in peace and equity? When will the day arrive that black people no longer have to devote their time, talent, and energy struggling against white racism? This is her warning, but her answer is, if it is never, we must all brace ourselves for the coming of a most atrocious doomsday. Not being a doomsday prophet, Dr. Williams begins this essay asking the very same questions as the prophet Jeremiah. Is God not in Zion? Is there no balm in Gilead? And then she adds her own question. Where is the healing the church is supposed to offer? This scripture passage, Jeremiah 9, closely echoed my own emotional and spiritual state for days and weeks after the November 8, 2016 election. I mourned, and dismay had taken hold of me, but I was not alone. The climate in the nation was tense, and many were fearful that the future and the course of the nation taken under a questionable administration would be difficult. But again, I find myself reading another Dolores S. Williams writing, searching for a balm in Gilead, and rediscovered her prophetic comfort and reminder that indeed there is still a balm in Gilead. She says this, I have concluded that the prophet Jeremiah long ago provided a response that is relevant for today. Speaking God's word to the people, the prophet said, thus says God, I am God who practices steadfast love, justice, and righteousness in the earth, for in these things I delight. From this, she assures us that the same healing balm of Gilead sought by Jeremiah is still available to us, but there are conditions under which its healing power can be poured out and received. She challenges the church to be the church and calls us to action. She is careful to distinguish between those churches and congregations that offer a healing balm to all people and those who do not. She plainly tells us that all Christian churches must do this in order to fully be the church of Christ. Dr. Williams shows us the difference between Zion and Gilead. By using a black Christian cultural interpretation of this scriptural passage, she tells us that Zion represents the whole church, but more specifically, white Protestant mainline denominations, many of whom have not been instruments of pouring out God's love to all people. This tradition also holds that Gilead represents the black church in all of its denominational differences, because it has been from the black church that God's healing power has historically been manifested and poured out on African American Christians and others who go to African American churches. In any church, the words love, Justice and righteousness can be preached and proclaimed, but what do the messengers, you know, the preachers and teachers, really mean? And what messages are given to the people in relation to the issues facing the Christian church today? People of all marginalized cultural groups have been challenged, have challenged the church to rid itself of sexism, homophobia, misogyny, social class distinctions, white supremacy, and racism, and to act out the love, justice, and righteousness it has been charged to preach so that all Christians can realize wholeness within the community. Dr. Williams reminds the whole church that there should be no distinctions between people, cultures, races, or gender, and that we are supposed to be the instrument through which God's healing power is poured out into the world. Yet she adds a qualifier, attaching the word tough, so that we do not operate in simple love, justice, and righteousness, but in tough love, tough justice, and tough righteousness. Tough love, as described by Dr. Williams, is nothing like the phrase made popular by a particular evangelical religious leader. Rather, it is a love based on the principles of Scripture and equality for all people. For her, tough love means that sometimes the church must oppose the church, especially when the church policies exclude those who live on the fringes and edges of society from the Christian community, or when the church continues to sanction its own oppressive ethical and moral status quo to alienate and isolate the marginalized, and when its ecclesiastical structures prohibit equality in the church. She calls the church to become politically involved, to press legislators, legal systems, and government agencies to live up to what a democracy is supposed to do for all its citizens, regardless of race, color, wealth, social class, or sexual orientation. Her tough justice calls the church to initiate and move toward exercising a public display of its advocacy for equality before the law for all people. The church must oppose the oppressive weight of the prison industrial complex on the lives of the poor in the United States. It must participate in the struggle for survival and productive quality of life for all people. And it must provide healing power for the guiltless and the guilty. She says that the church must remember that righteousness means being faithful to the law of God. Tough righteousness then means to adhere to this law, which is to love God with all of our heart, soul, and mind, and to love our neighbors as ourselves. To live out tough love, tough righteousness means that your neighbors are not just your friends, the ones who live next door, or your family, but your neighbors are those whose society has relegated to its borders, placed outside the status quo, and determined valueless. Dr. Williams reminds us that the heart of the law of God is love. This love is the foundation of justice and the meaning of care in the church community. The church today must be restored to itself as a balm in Gilead. The church must be restored in order to do its tough work of justice making that pours out a healing balm upon all people in the name of love and in the command of God's righteousness. Only then can the church be the church. Not much has changed in the social and political fabric of the country since Dr. Williams began publishing her writings in 1985. These articles have revealed to us that we are still faced with the same insidious perpetuation of incestuous racism that is promoted through false propaganda, alternative facts, religious, social, and scientific lies, misappropriation of scripture, and purposeful misleading of segments of the population aimed at keeping hate and hateful activities brewing in an attempt to make America great again. Demonarchy still exists. Racism is still the undercurrent fabric of the nation. Genocide is still a frightening possibility. Desecration of houses of worship and sacred sites continues. The church has not addressed racism, and hate groups are visible and on the rise. Yet, the prophetic voice of Dr. Williams, alongside biblical prophets, continues to remind us that despite what we see and hear, there is still hope. And we see glimpses of that hope today in the numbers of people and organizations who have rallied together and are speaking out against immoral and unethical practices and policies in government. Concerned churches and religious leaders are speaking up, standing up, and calling out America's original sin. Ecumenical and interfaith coalitions work together across cultures and faith to build communities. Sanctuary cities are forming to protect immigrants. Seminaries such as CTS continue to confront racism with thought-provoking courses, seminars, and workshops. When we participate in tough love, tough justice, and tough righteousness, then we express the outpouring of God's love, justice, and righteousness that will bring forth healing in the land, and we will become God's healing balm poured out upon the people. When, as Dr. Williams has reminded us, the church operates in tough love, tough justice, and tough righteousness, there will be a healing balm in Gilead. There is a balm in Gilead to make the wounded whole. There is a balm in Gilead to heal the sin-sick soul. Thank you.
I think I saw one of your slides that said that the alt-right was a loosely organized group. Do you think, and then the last couple of slides back, you showed a couple of photos, and they are people in government. And do you think that the alt-right is much more organized than is apparent by the randomness of alt-right attacks?
I think it is more organized than they'd like us to believe. The things that we see, and even Dr. Williams addressed it, seems to have been lying dormant and quiet. But just because it was dormant and quiet did not mean it wasn't active and doing what it needed to do. And I think that this particular season just makes a ripeness for some things to just pop out. You can't pop out like it is now to be new. It has to be something that has been ongoing. So I do think that it's not been hidden. It's been here all along. We just now call it this term, but it's been operating for years.
This is more of a comment, but I'm just wondering if, from the vein of the conversation and what Dr. Terrell just brought up, as I was listening to the campaign, and I started reading, and I was actually reading Stand Your Ground, it sounded like there were some themes and some theme words that were being called out, giving like this signal. And I'm just wondering if Dr. Williams mentioned any of that.
Mm-hmm. In these articles, she did not. Of course, this was many years before this particular season. And it seems that right now we're dealing with folk who are a little bolder than they were then and, you know, not afraid to speak out. But she did call out what she saw, and I think she addressed it clearly as demonarchy and asked us to be on guard. What do we see? You know, many times things happen and we just kind of go by, but she's telling us we have to pay attention. And those words, those code words, we have to know the code. We have to understand that Make America Great Again meant something very different than what it was told that it meant.
Well, question. Thank you, Dr. Murphy, for your lecture. We were back here tweeting you and Facebooking you and all of that good stuff. I'm really struck by the opening when you talked about many people will just look at sisters in the wilderness and never get the kind of full body of work that mm-hmm. you've unveiled for us. Can you speak to, perhaps you are already speaking to, if Williams could write another book, or if there were things that weren't explained fully or even fully engaged in her Sisters in the Wilderness, do you think that these other articles give us another layer to understand Williams? And what do we call that? Is that something that is just like womanist work, or is that perhaps some sense of a political theology that she's forming?
I think it would still sit under womanist theology, and it might expand it. It would be wonderful if she had written another book. But such as it is, we have to dig through what she has given us as it is now. These articles, and there's so many more, and there's so many more things that she has talked about that line up with this, and I had to be real specific to just pull out just enough for now. But there are many other things that can be read, and the list that I gave you is not even close to what she's written. There's an article that she wrote after she took a visit to South Africa, where she talked about looking at the people in South Africa and were they going to be able to govern now that it had changed, and looking at, but there are still strongholds here. You know, there are still strongholds of apartheid, even though supposedly it has ended. But those things all, and she overlapped it with where we see ourselves. So there are a lot more articles to be read and to be uncovered, and perhaps we can come up with something else that would have a theological stand and another theological name, but right now it's got to sit with what I call the prophetic voice of Dolores Williams.
So Dr. Williams said in Sisters that the genocidal intent of the American system against black folk calls for a permanent posture of self-defense. So what kinds of action does that entail on our part? What kind of preparation, action, what should the church be teaching? What should the church be doing to help people completely thwart that genocidal intent of the nation against black folk?
I think the church is afraid to label that kind, or label racism sin. And so if the church, all of the church, labels racism and racist acts as sin, then that's the first step for me.
When you say the church, you mean the black church or the whole church?
The whole church. The whole church. So we must understand that when you mistreat, well, we say that we know it, but how do we act it? Because you have some who claim to be Christian, but who can misinterpret where it says
is the white church Christian?
That's why I call it Christianity American style.
Okay.
So rather than just calling out and saying no, because that's a blanket statement, but if it's American style, for me it's questionable. To get back to the other part is what else can we do? We as those who are learned, first of all, we must learn the history. We have to know the history. We have to know what has taken place. And then we have to teach what we know to everybody. Some will hear it and receive it, some won't, but nevertheless, we have to know history. What is that phrase? If you don't know history, it's bound to repeat itself. That's one.
I'm sorry I'm hogging the microphone, but I really am so disappointed at the woefully unprepared students to even see history. To even see the gaps in the historical timelines that I asked them to create for systematic theology. I always ask that. And people are so woefully unprepared to acknowledge the existence, much less the oppression of black folk in this country and around the world. That even the contributions, nothing. It does not occur to people, and I'm these are supposed to be people of complete goodwill who have no idea about Brown versus the Board of Education and all of that. Nothing. Okay. Let me get off the soapbox. But really, they're just woefully unprepared to recognize that without that crucial piece, your theology is going to be messed up. And I see that in congregations too, whose people are not prepared to recognize a small fact of black oppression in this country.
So I think Dr. Williams addressed that when she said that the conditioning of particularly the white church to continue to hold on to their anti-black sentiment, they may not even realize in front of them that that's what they're doing. But she's addressed that. And that's why I think it is on us who know to put the history in front of them. Because sometimes it's been intentional and sometimes it hasn't. But that's what I consider my job. I've got to put the history in front of people who don't know it. And then when they know it, it's up to them to do with it as they should, hopefully.
I want to thank you for your lecture and bringing to light more of the work that Dr. Williams had put out there that many of us didn't know about. One day I want to ask you more about taking a class with her. I mean, I'm always into finding out more about a person than besides, you know, their own work. So I'm sure there's so much that you could add to understanding who she was as a professor. And I think that was great that you were able to experience that and share. I guess I had it's sort of a question comment. I guess after hearing what you have said and even if we reflect on the things that Williams tells us that we should do and going out and educating, like Dr. Thoreau was saying, that a lot of people are unprepared. I think this is kind of a comment too, whereas I really see a lot of it is within especially black churches that do not want to talk about this, is the whole, I mean, capitalism and patriarchy together is a huge problem within especially black communities and the black churches, because the concern is about buildings, it's about, you know, mm-hmm. what we have to prove that we are a successful ministry, and all of the issues that should be a priority are getting, you know, the back seat or the back pew. And so you have people that are more focused on those things because they don't want to go to the tough issues because other people aren't doing it. So it's almost like when I try to tell one of my children, you need to do the right thing. Well, they aren't doing it, so why should I do the right thing? So I wanted to know what you would recommend or what you would have us to do after we leave here. I mean, I guess some of us, we take it back to our church, but I'm always thinking about the practical questions. How can we get this? Because the solution is here. And what we need to do, but how are we going to get this even further so we can get people who are representing, black churches. And I understand that a lot of the people supporting those mindsets are that mindset are black women because they don't know any better. So I just wanted to know, what you would recommend as far as us carrying this forward. Because this is, like I said, this is a solution that we have here, but how do we apply it and take it out further?
A lot of that's going to depend upon what the climate in your particular church is. What can you take back to your church? What can you do as an individual there? And sometimes you're just going to have to be the only voice shouting in a space for a long time. Dr. Williams actually does address in a few other articles the issue about the economics connected to capitalism and democracy. I didn't want to go there tonight because it's a whole nother thing all by itself. But she's laid the groundwork. So my suggestion would be is to find some of these articles or articles written by other people who are concerned about these things. Find out what they have said, what they suggest, and then see if you can apply those same suggestions to your situation or adapt them to fit where you are. The first thing to me is always going to be teaching the history, letting us know as a people who we are, what we stand for, that all of these things have in fact been lies from the very beginning, and that racism is built on a lie. And then to help people understand that everything you talked about in terms of, we got to have building, we got to have this, those things, those are the things that are also a tool of keeping you suppressed.
Dr. Murphy, I just want to say this was wonderful.
Thank you.
And thank you for using the term prophetic. So often women are not even considered to be prophetic voices. And then more importantly, because she was a woman, she is a woman writing in the academy, often we don't associate the prophetic with that kind of work. Hmm. My question to you is, who is her audience?
At the time that she was writing, her audience was the theological academy. But she also had her foot in the church. She knew well what it was to be a church woman. To kind of piggyback on what you said, being able to be around her and listen to her talk about the old folk, who she called the old folk, and the stories and the songs of the old folk. So her audience is twofold. She was writing for the academy, but she also knew how to speak to folk who weren't in the academy. She had a double audience. Unfortunately, many of people in the church don't know anything about her. If I raise a question or mention her name, who? Unless a person happened to go to school, to seminary. That's the only way most people know. So I would like to just have her name out there more boldly for all of us to know. Because she does speak to all of us. She doesn't just speak to African Americans. She speaks to all of us and what all of us are called. She's not one who decided that I would only speak to this group. No, she spoke to everybody.
I want to add my voice of gratitude to those that have already spoken. I'm overjoyed to see you there and doing this work. And please forgive me as I'm thinking through my question, but kind of along the lines of what you just said and kind of what's been in the air, the atmosphere, in terms of who her audience is. My question is related to, from your readings of her additional articles, do you sense that she has a word for those outside of the church? And what I mean by that is the language that she uses is the language of the theological academy and the church, but yet there is a spirit in her work that is not bound by those institutions. But because of that language, those who are also not bound by those institutions, yet they may have respect for them and honor them, may not be able to see past the language. So my question is, could you sense and find in her work how she's speaking beyond those institutions
that are Christian in nature or seem to have a Christian overlay to them?
I think that though it is predominantly dealing with Christians, it's very easy for me to take those words and just make them more generic so that one will understand if you are not treating someone right, that's wrong. So you will understand if your understanding of African American or other people comes from some of those old ways of understanding, for instance, the definition of black. If you can understand, if we can point people to that, it can come out of the church and still speak to someone who doesn't feel as though church is what they need to do. I think her words are still very, very important, and they can do that. I haven't read thoroughly every one of the 50 articles yet, but there may even be something that she has already done. So it's well worth, for me, the work to do that.
We're just about out of time here. We can do one more question, or...
book that we're looking for from Williams, but also to be part of your collection about this is womanist work, mining these sources and pulling together in ways. Certainly we're familiar with women, with Williams, but to this depth is something that the print sources themselves won't even allow when they're out of print, right? And you can't find everything you need to get having that in a book places a new lens to it, and then framing it within prophetic discourse allows us to understand how you're reading, but also to read Williams anew. So I want to affirm this coming into some compilation for your own work.
Thank you.
That was a great comment to go out on. Let's thank Reverend Dr. Murphy again.